Hello there. Welcome to the Saroy channel. How are you doing? I do hope you're doing remarkably well, and loads of love to each and every one of you. And I hope that you're ready to relax after a long, hard day at work, or a soak in the bubble bath, because I've got a fabulous story for you tonight. So don't forget to go and get that wonderful quintessential drink, whether it's a rich, hot, warm drink or a spicy Dr. Pepper, because I've got a fabulous story for you tonight. And don't forget to let me know where you're from if you haven't before, and what you enjoy drinking, because I've got a lovely story for you tonight. So before you get started, don't forget to subscribe to the channel, click the notification bell, and the thumbs up, and let's get started with tonight's story. Dear Sarah, and all your lovely listeners, it was a warm, pleasant day in Seattle, Washington. Not too hot, not too cold. The temperature was pleasingly pleasant, perfect for a spot of shopping. The tall, sultry oak trees that fringed the pavements of the street swayed their boughs gently in the wind, while their leaves rustled. I had one thing on my mind, and one thing only, and that was to buy my little 3-year-old niece a pretty little princess dress for her up-and-coming 4th birthday party. I knew exactly where to buy it, as there was a perfect cute little boutique kiddie shop in Seattle called the Little Princess that sold these fabulous princess outfits with the wide ethereal but stiff silk ballerinic frills that projected horizontally from the waist, attached to a glittering bodice of silvery rhinestones, sequins and French diamante, that made every little girl look like the quintessential princess. "It's so beautiful," said the shop assistant, "and so painstakingly made by hand. So every single one of these dresses is a unique work of art in its own right." She said this, folding the pretty pink dress into layers of pink tissue paper, smiling at me enthusiastically. "You know, I never get tired of selling pretty princess dresses like this to children. Your niece is going to love this one. I do adore the clusters of material flowers above the tutu skirt." I nodded. She is going to love it. My little niece always fancies herself as a princess. The effusive, rather gregarious shop assistant, who I was to later learn was in fact the owner, proceeded to wrap up a flowering, sparkling, twinkling and shimmering crown, or tiara if you like, that was made of realistic-looking pretty pink and white flowers, interspersed with glittering rhinestones that complemented the dress superbly, as every princess needs an illustrious crown. This one was unique, personalised, marvellously special. My niece was absolutely going to love it. All of a sudden the glass door of the boutique swung open violently, causing the door to creak, the inside bell to jingle. A stranger came bolting into the store, bringing in with him a fear that travelled on the wind like an invisible smoke, so that the whole shop was clouded, enveloped in such an oppressive energy that you could tangibly feel it, rather like a pungent, offensive perfume that makes you want to hurl. Believe me, fear has a smell or essence all of its own. A bitter, stinky, sour, rank, sweaty, nauseatingly sweet smell that clings to the air with a vinegary, biting, acidic, claustrophobic bouquet. The young man was in his early 20s with a crop of full blonde hair, a slightly spotty chin, a pair of pale blue eyes that were filled with a foreboding dread. He screamed, "They're going to kill me! Call the police! Call the police!" Two intemperate, hot-headed, homicidal thugs bolted into the shop, one grabbing the man forcefully by the chest, throwing, plunging, crashing him to the ground into a kneeling position, while the other one was waving the revolver around in his hands precariously. "Get down," he said to me and the shop assistant in a demanding, no-nonsense voice. "Get down onto the floor, both of you. On your knees with your hands above your heads, or I will blow your heads off. Get that? I'll bloody kill the both of you." Fear coursed through my veins while my heart pounded violently in my chest. My body was physically shaking, wobbling and jiggling like a mould of jello. "Please, please," I begged, my eyes filling with tears, pouring down my face in floods like raindrops on a glass window pane. "Please don't kill me. Please, please don't kill me." "Take anything you want," cried the shop assistant. "Anything, absolutely anything you want." She was now crouched on her knees, her body trembling in trepidation, while her eyes were so filled with an undisguised horror. "There's lots of money in the till.
Please take it. Take anything. As I said, anything you want. But please, please don't hurt us. The man that was cowering down on the carpeted floor was now drenched in his own sweat. His white T-shirt clung to his body like a limp rag. He was lying in a clenched heap, his hands covering his head. He looked as if he was in a Muslim temple, bowing prostrate. In what seemed like a second, he was kicked violently by one of the thugs with his heavy steel-rimmed boots, with no mercy spared, as those kicks were crushingly brutal, very vicious, like someone intent on squashing a roach to death, while the cold metal of a revolver was now cocked at his head. The boy began to squirm and scream out in pain.
"Any last words, Josh, before I pull this trigger?"
The young man was ashen, his skin as white as a sheet. The sweat was pouring down his face. He looked at the men with pleading, begging, desperate eyes.
"I told you! I told you I will get you the money! I promise I will get you it! I'll pay you back!"
"Like hell you will! You know the rules around here. You broke the code of ethics. It's a bullet on the side of the head. You were warned about this before you got involved with us. We always warn everyone."
"There's no need to kill him," came the brave, stoic voice of the shop assistant. "How much money does he owe you? I'll pay you."
$20,000, woman. That's how much he owes us."
I can get you the money," said the woman. But please, please don't kill him. You can't kill him. Please don't kill him. I beg you. I can get you the money."
"Shut up, woman. This isn't your bloody business. This is personal. It's not always about money. It's about loyalty, honour, obedience. It has nothing to do with you. But it will if you don't shut your bloody mouth up right now, woman."
Then it happened. The man pulled back the trigger. Boom. The young man fell back onto the carpet with a mighty thud. His dead fish-like eyes glazed as they stared vacantly into space. Only a second ago he was breathing, but now he was an empty shell, a vessel. The essence of who he once was, vaporized like the mist on your truck window once the heater is engaged. My body heaved, jolted, jumped in reaction to the shrill ear-piercing popping sound of the bullet, as if I myself had been shot, for it was as if the whole floor that I was kneeling on had become wobbly, unsteady, rickety, like a fisherman's boat on a tempestuous sea. I realized that this was because my whole body was a gibbering, gelatinous mess. For a moment the illustrious Princess Boutique seemed to shudder, palpitate, quiver, quake, as the carpeted floors absorbed the shock of this horrifying horror that was now indelibly printed on the fabric of time, that although no longer visible, hung there like a silken fibre from a spider's web, never ever to be forgotten, for the lifeblood of this man was in this place. Then all was very still. You could have heard a pin drop, as both men scuttled to their feet, running out of the shop fast, down the street at the speed of light, to make quick their escape. I wish I could say that me and the shop assistant reacted with a savvy speed and efficiency by calling the police at once. I regret we did not, for shock incapacitated us, holding us hostage in a suspended state of disbelief. It was as if what had transpired was really only an insidious nightmare from which we would surely wake. We were only jolted out of our wobbly state when a woman entered the boutique, the doorbell jingling as she pushed it open. She stopped dead in her tracks, her eyes growing wide with horror, as she let out a discomposing scream, running out of the boutique screaming, "Someone's been shot! Someone's been shot!" It was her scream on seeing the dead corpse lying on the floor with the blood trailing on the carpet that jolted us out of our delirium. "Someone's been shot! Someone's been shot in my shop!" said the shop assistant, wobbling nervously as she clutched the phone in her hands, speaking to the emergency services. "Someone's been shot! Yes, at the Little Princess! At the Little Princess Boutique! We need the police right now!" Of course, the police were invariably called, and me and the shop assistant were escorted to the station to answer a host of questions, to look at mug shots of well-known criminals, and we even sat in for a police artist to draw the young men we'd both seen, who the police were certain were involved in a notorious drug cartel with a repugnant reputation for killing any wayward dealers. So harrowing, tortuous and distressing was this experience for me personally that it rattled my life to such an extent that I was never the same again. It was as if the whole chilling experience was replaying itself in my mind, over and over and over again, on rewind, rather like a roller coaster that just would not abate. At the time, I was living outside Seattle, in a large Georgian house that had been subdivided into three separate residential homes that on the outside looked like one substantial, grandiose mansion. Only you could see the three separate pathways that led directly to three separate front doors, all painted in distinguished different colours to procure our identity, and of course to ascertain each house one from the other, so that visitors to my home knew that mine was the one front door that was painted in a navy blue colour. The very ornate white property overlooked a large sprawling open graveyard, with tombstones so old, some were literally covered in algae and lichen, that was flanked in the furthest distance by a towering woodgrove made up of Douglas firs and ponderosa pines. Ever since the gut-wrenching violent ordeal at the fairy-tale-like Princess Boutique, it was no surprise that the cute little expression of a little girl's dream had now closed its doors, as the shock of the incident meant that even the owner of this whimsical, wistful enterprise could not stomach her job any more, as memories of the incident hung like a sticky spider-web over her life, clouding her aspirations in an oppressive darkness, and try as she might, she could not get rid of those silken fibres that stuck to her visionary hopes and dreams for the place like nasty bits of tacky chewing gum that you could not shift. Ostensibly, the traumatizing memories, along with the haunting flashbacks, tore into the fabric of her soul, much as it had done for me. I had resigned from my job as a local school teacher at school. I was receiving trauma counseling at home, but I had reached a stage where I couldn't leave my own premises. I was compounded by such an excruciating, tormenting terror that had made me become a prisoner in my own home. If I did try to leave my house, I was gripped by such an insufferable terror, so much so that I would break out into a cold sweat, followed by panic attacks that were so extreme that on one occasion an ambulance was called. I thought I was dying of a heart attack. I was now having my groceries delivered to my own home, living like a hermit or a princess locked away in an ivory tower.
"One step at a time," the counsellor had assured me. "Trauma affects us all very differently. But I assure you, slowly and surely we will get there. You're suffering from agoraphobia, which is perfectly understandable in the circumstances. You've had a nasty, nasty shock. But in time you'll be as right as rain, and go back to resuming your normal life."
For me, the idea of my life ever resuming any sort of normality seemed a long way in the future.
"But what if that never happens?" I'd said. "What if I spend the rest of my life cooped up in this house, too afraid to ever leave?"
"I'm sure it won't come to that," the counsellor had assured me.
But I doubted he was right. I felt certain that never again would I have the courage to leave my front door. Of course my parents, along with my sister and my little niece, visited me regularly, repeating like a parrot exactly what the therapist had told me 100 times before. "Little steps. Slowly and surely you'll get back to living a normal life," they would say. But I could tell by the worried secret glances on their faces that their words did not convey what they really thought.
And so it was I would sit on the second floor of my home in the bedroom, with my window facing the graveyard, on a rocking chair, like a withering, frail old lady. I was young then, in my late 20s at the time, with the world as my oyster, but it certainly didn't feel like that. With my binoculars I would watch the comings and goings on our street, and of course the graveyard across the road, often frequented by curious people who were naturally drawn to the unnamed graves with an undisguised fascination. I don't know what it is about graveyards, but they seem to provoke a macabre interest. I suppose watching the comings and goings of the outside world was my one connection to it, which was why I became pretty much transfixed to whiling away the long lonely hours of my uninspiring drab life, just watching people. Granted, I got entertainment from television, videos and the internet alike, but they all seemed far removed from the hustle and bustle of the outside world. I could see Mrs. Jeffries walking her little dog through the gravestones. Her dog would lift up his leg on a tomb to pee against it, or decided to deliver a coiled, smelly package on some nearby turf. Mrs. Jeffries would glance around furtively to see if anyone had seen her dog's offence, of which she could have attended to easily, as her pocket was well equipped with some dog waste removal bags,
but having decided that they hadn't been seen, she would hastily waddle off with her dog, as if nothing had ever happened. It seemed getting away with doing something was exceedingly gratifying for her. Then there was my neighbour's three boys, who lived next door to me behind the yellow front door, all between the ages of 13 and 15, who enjoyed kicking a ball in the graveyard. On this occasion I watched them having the time of their lives, as there were lots of areas between the stones to kick a ball. I could see a pugnacious man with a bald, shiny head draw up his truck to the side of the road, where he trudged towards the boys with a purposeful, angry stride, pointing accusatory fingers at them, oscillating his arms wildly with his mouth going up and down, while the expression on his face appeared inflamed with anger. I could always fill in the blanks, imagine what he was saying.
"You bloody kids! What are you doing kicking a ball around a graveyard like this? Have you got no respect for the dead?"
This wasn't the first time an altercation like this had happened, so I knew those kids would be back to fight yet another day, seemingly unhindered by the constant telling off of passing strangers that was frankly not much of a deterrent at all. I watched them hang their heads in shame, dutifully, while the eldest boy appeared to be apologising profusely.
"Sorry, sir," I imagine he was saying. "I promise you, we won't do it again."
But, as he said this, his fingers were crossed behind his back.
The stranger, definitely suspicious, watched the children with a huge scowl on his face as they scurried hastily across the road to the pavement and grassy verge that framed our side of the road. The shortest one, whom I imagine was the youngest, was clutching the ball tightly in his hands. With their faces now facing away from the disagreeable man, they were laughing. I watched the man get in his truck and drive off. One night I was awoken to a banging sound. I could hear some clattering going on in the neighbour's kitchen. I was downstairs at the time, having fallen asleep in front of the television. The dividing wall between my neighbour's kitchen and the living area was so superfine it was easy to overhear conversations, especially since the whole family next door perpetually spoke with raised voices. I glanced towards my living room clock. It was midnight. My sliding door that led out into the front yard had block-out curtains that clearly needed drawing, but the distracting, raised, belligerent voices in the neighbour's kitchen sharpened my attention. I was immensely curious to find out what was going on. And like a snooping, nosy neighbour who hasn't got anything better to do with their time, I scurried towards the wall to have a really good listen in to a conversation clearly not designed for my ears to hear. In truth, I was always hungry for entertainment. I had an insatiable desire and secret hankering for excitement in my life, as being a prisoner in my own home meant life could get tediously boring for me. I pressed my ears against the wall, listening in to the conversation. "You stupid bloody idiot," I could hear a young male voice say. "It's a good job Mum and Dad are out. If they knew you used his rifle, you'd be in real shit. You silly idiot. How could you do that? You weren't meant to use it unless we had to. We were just following him into the woods, but no, you couldn't hold it together, could you, bro? You're the oldest. Why did you insist on shooting him? He was running away from us, not to us, you idiot. You shot at him in cold blood. It's disgusting. What if he comes after us? He might have seen where we live. Did you even stop to think of the ramifications of shooting him? It could come back to bite us, but no, you didn't think, did you, bro? You just reacted like you always do, without engaging your brain. Don't be silly. He won't come after us. Why would he do that? You saw him. He ran into the woods. He's gone. He's frightened. He'll leave us alone. Yes, but he's badly injured. You hurt him, bro. Your bullet went right through the side of his chest. He bolted away. But what if there are others like him out there? You heard that other scream. Where did that come from? It could have been another member of his family out there. If they've seen where we live, heaven help us, bro. That's all I can say. I should have been the one carrying the rifle. I knew I should. You may be older than me, but by golly, I'm the one with the brains around here. They could hurt us. They could seek revenge. Maybe they're watching us from the trees. Oh, stop being so dramatic. We'll stay away from the graveyard for a while. Let the dust settle. In case he's around, that is, I'm sure it'll be fine. You don't think he's going to die? Came a little subdued voice, which I imagine came from the youngest boy. It'll be a good thing if he does die. If he sees us again, he might recognise us. There's no telling what he'll do. No one must say a word about this to Mum or Dad. If Dad knew I used his rifle, I'll be grounded.
Won't he be able to tell if you've used it? Came the little voice again. Can't you tell if a rifle's been used? I heard you can. What about the used ammo?
Of course not, silly. Dad doesn't know we know where he keeps the key to his rifle cabinet, does he? If he discovers something untowards in regard to his rifle, he won't suspect a thing, because we don't know where he keeps the key. If he asks us, we act as if he's completely bonkers. I'm sure he's going to put it down to him being a little absent-minded. He won't suspect a thing, I know he won't. The main thing is we have to keep our lips sealed. They'll be back in the morning, so don't go giving away anything. No hangdog guilty expressions on your faces, or Mum will think we're up to something. Now let's go to bed. Forget this ever happened.
But you're sure this thing won't come back to haunt us?
Of course not, came the reassuring voice that sounded rather too wobbly to me, as if the person wasn't confident at all in what they were saying, but were trying to convince their flagging doubts. Naturally, I was absolutely stunned. I mean, had these three children actually shot a man in the woods? Why would they do such a crazy thing? I didn't know how to react. Now I was wide awake. I decided to backtrack on the video that I'd been watching, return to the point before I'd fallen asleep. My body was covered in a long duvet on the sofa, my bent legs crushed against my chest as I dived into a bowl of salted caramel popcorn, swigging down a cold glass of Mountain Dew, which I placed on the coffee table before me. Before long, I got caught up in the gripping, compelling drama, where two men with black stockings on their faces were creeping cautiously into a house through a sliding door much like my own. My heart began to thump in my chest. Why on earth was I watching something that only provoked my worst fears? Wasn't this supposed to be a comedy? But in my book, this was nothing funny. Nothing was funny about this at all. I could feel my angst intensify, reminding myself that I hadn't drawn the blockout curtains of my sliding door. I moved surreptitiously towards the windows, my nerves frazzled by a rising level of trepidation that the movie had clearly evoked in me. I stopped dead in my tracks. My body froze like an ice statue. As staring at me through my own glass windows were two huge human-like faces from 7 feet off the ground, of two monstrous giants covered in lots and lots of hair. Of course I couldn't see them clearly, but their faces were pressed against the window pane, looking directly at me. I could see an ominous thick sausage-sized finger fingering the corner of my slightly ajar sliding door, pushing it back until it finally opened. A burst of cold breeze entered the room, followed by two powerfully intimidating creatures that were so dauntingly big they would make a refrigerator seem small. At first it seemed like a joke, as if two men in gorilla suits had entered my living room and were playing some kind of bizarre, twisted, nonsensical joke on me. But my eyes could see clearly that this wasn't a practical joke of any kind. These creatures were absolutely real. I could see willowy smoke emerging from the aquatic nostrils of the larger creature, who looked less than amused. Her grey leathery face wore an expression of incandescent rage. All at once I knew what these creatures were. The revelation hit me like a ton of bricks. They were Bigfoots. I had two Bigfoots in my living room, whose eyes were focused directly on me. This was some kind of ridiculous and exceedingly bizarre event. The larger Bigfoot was female, easily over 8 foot tall, 3 foot wide across the shoulder area, 700 pounds easily. The Bigfoot who was standing next to her was whimpering like a child, and although big, he was lanky, lean, muscular, at about 7 foot tall, he was unequivocally still a youngling. I could see a big patch of congealed blood on the side of his muscular, dense chest that appeared almost bulletproof. He was holding it down with his hand. It was clear he was in pain, but I did not perceive that any lasting damage had actually been done, because the creature was in good shape. I then realized that this was the creature the next-door neighbor's kid had shot with his father's rifle. It seemed that the female, who was his mother, had come to extract her revenge upon the boy. The trouble was, she had come to the far end of the house, which was my section of the old mansion. The Bigfoot had got the right house, but the wrong section of the house. She had chosen the blue front door instead of the yellow one, which was where the three boys lived. The huge female creature looked at me through her treacle-coloured, wide, deep-set eyes, pointing directly at her youngling's wound and showing me the blood, as if to say, "Look what you've done! You've hurt my son!" She moved towards my settee, thrashing it across the ground so hard that the underlying wooden scaffolding and upholstery just broke, like a brittle bar of peanut brittle snapping in half.
She was about to lunge towards another piece of my furniture to tear it apart when the whimpering Bigfoot started chattering to its mother in a very articulate language. It was shaking its head profusely, as if to say, "It's not her, Mum. It's not her. She isn't the one that hurt me." I watched the mother's face visibly soften. Her animosity towards me slowly waned, faded, subsided, relaxed. She looked almost apologetic, but continued to point to her son's wound, as if to say, "Can you see why I'm angry? Someone did this to my son." I nodded. "I'm sorry," I said, speaking audibly in English, hoping that in some way she might understand me. "You must be very upset. Very, very upset, but believe me, it was all an accident. I'm sure the person who shot your boy didn't actually mean to do it." The female Bigfoot was studying me. She was looking at me directly in the eyes. I swear to you, she could read my mind. I knew she could. It was like she was reading me like a book. "I am 1,000% sure these creatures are telepathic, so you have got to guard your thoughts in their presence. If you forgive me for saying so," I continued, "but it's easy to be scared by your kind. You're awfully big. I can understand why it happened. People do silly things when they're scared." The Bigfoot looked at me again through her dark eyes, as if assimilating my words. I beckoned for the two creatures to follow me. At first they were hesitant, but then they reluctantly obliged, and I led them into my kitchen, indicating for the little one, or the youngling, to sit on my kitchen chair, while I began to clean up the wound with some disinfectant. The water in the sink became saturated with blood, but I could see the wound was already healing. It was a very superficial wound. The mind boggles at how tough and robust these creatures actually are. He was a lucky Bigfoot, for it was clear he would live to fight another day. I was very fortunate that my Uncle Pedro was a practicing trauma surgeon in Seattle, so I knew a thing or two about bullet wounds. I fidgeted around with my sterilized finger underneath the skin to find myself touching something cold and hard in the narrow cavity of the open gash. It was the bullet. I could hardly believe it. I pulled it out, hardly daring to believe that so little damage had been done, and that the bullet hadn't even gone through the body, as you would have expected, which was rather weird. But then the Bigfoot's body was so dense with muscle. I heard of a woman once with a gunshot wound that was lodged in her breast implant, and the implant saved her life, as the bullet became wedged in the gel. In this case, the muscle density of the creature's body had saved his life. I marvelled at the wound, that it was so superficial. In truth, this very same bullet could have killed a human in a heartbeat, but to this creature it was merely a graze, but a graze that hurt him a lot. I washed the bullet under the warm water tap. The water tap going on and off was a source of great fascination for both Bigfoots, who kept turning it on and off themselves with looks of unrestrained astonishment on their faces. The ambience in the kitchen was warm, cosy, congenial, and any previous hostility the female creature may have felt for me had long since dissipated like the steam from a kettle. I handed the wash bullet over to the little creature, who examined it with awe. The expression on his face was one that was absolutely thrilled. He was over the moon. He handed the bullet over to his mother, who studied the object curiously, rolling it around in her sausage-sized fingers. But the little creature snapped it away from her, as if to say, "No, it's mine! I want it!" He rolled it around in his hands, looking as pleased as Punch with his newly acquired strange possession, while the female Bigfoot looked slightly disheartened and deflated that she had nothing of her own to treasure. So I immediately made amends by handing her the sizable rose quartz stone that I had balancing on the window ledge, a present recently given to me by my sister, who believed that after the horrifying shooting at the Princess Boutique that I had experienced, that the rose quartz would ward off negative emotions, replacing them with positive ones. "It'll bring you balance in your life," she assured me. I'd seen the female Bigfoot eyeing the rose quartz earlier on as she had entered the kitchen, much like a magpie who admired a glittering jewel. I handed it to her, placing the stone in her hands while looking at her directly in the eyes. "This is to say sorry for what those boys did to your boy," I told her. She grabbed the quartz, rolling it around in her hands, unable to disguise the look of rapturous glee on her face, as she let out an excited whoop, whoop, her eyes shining with an ecstatic appreciation, an enthusiasm and joy that I have yet to see in a human being. I mean, this Bigfoot mama was absolutely over the moon with my gift. I then bustled around in the kitchen to make the Bigfoot's peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, which they ate with jubilant gusto. The female creature looked at me, nudged my shoulder, giving it a tight squeeze as if to say thanks, and then I watched the two of them gliding away so gracefully under the light of the moon and the gentle infusion of the street lights. They darted through the gravestones towards the wooded area that flanked the cemetery. I was so sad to see them go, because in truth I've never, ever entertained such exciting guests before. I felt a true connection with the female Bigfoot. I knew that the boys next door would sleep peacefully in their beds that night, as those two Bigfoots would not be coming back to extract their revenge. The next morning I woke up a new woman, surprised to discover that the fear that had imprisoned me for so long appeared to have vanished. The idea of leaving my front door, walking outside, no longer seemed so daunting. It was as if my encounter with the two Bigfoots had knocked me out of my fear. I was certain my agoraphobia had completely gone, melted away like the butter on a blueberry pancake. How had that happened? I couldn't even fathom. I smiled as I thought about the two Bigfoots that I'd encountered in the early hours of the morning. I thought about them. They'd been so human, so incredibly emotionally intelligent. Nothing like the Bigfoots I'd heard described on television before. They were always described as ape-like humanoids, predisposed to being aggressive. Perhaps, I thought to myself, they are misunderstood. It was that afternoon that I opened the front door of my home for the first time in 2 years, walking towards the neighbour's bright yellow door. I knew the boys would be at home by now from school, while their parents were working in Seattle. The youngest boy, called Declan, opened the door to me. He looked up at me in surprise. "Aren't you the lady who lives next door? The lady who's too scared to leave her house?" he asked. "The very same," I said, thinking how fast news travelled, as everyone clearly knew about the crazy lady who locked herself away in her home like a princess in her ivory castle. "But you're not scared any more, are you? 'Cause you wouldn't be here otherwise, would you?" "No," I said, "I'm not scared any more." The boy was staring at me through the door as though observing an anomalous creature at the zoo that he couldn't quite figure out. "Do you mind if I come in?" I asked. "I'd like to speak to you and your brothers, if I may." The boy shrugged his shoulders in a nonchalant way. "Sure," he said, opening the door, letting me into the house. I was guided into the kitchen with its paper-thin wall, from which I had gleaned many a conversation. The two older boys were in the kitchen, buttering bread and piling it high with sliced turkey, cheese and tomatoes. They looked up in surprise to see me. "This is my older brother, Caden," he said, pointing to the older boy, "and this is Zachary. This is the lady from next door, who's too scared to leave her house, remember?" The boys looked at me with an intrigued interest. "Want a sandwich, miss?" Caden asked me. "It's really no trouble. We've got lots of turkey and cheese going spare." "No, thanks, I've already eaten." "Suit yourself," said Caden, beckoning for me to take a seat at the breakfast nook that looked like a collector's eclectic piece from the 1970s, where all three brothers, with plates decked out with sandwiches, slid next to each other, taking seats on the opposite side of the nook, facing me. "What is this all about, ma'am?" asked Caden, taking a large bite of his sandwich. "It's about what happened last night." At this, all three boys froze like wax statues at Madame Tussauds, their eyes pinned on me. "I know all about the Bigfoot you shot." Caden almost choked on his sandwich. "It was an accident. I got scared. I didn't mean to do it."
"He didn't mean to do it, miss. He didn't mean to do it," Declan insisted. It was an accident."
"The name's Paisley," I said. "Paisley Skylark, but you can call me Paisley."
"How do you know about this, Miss Paisley?" asked Caden, looking rather astonished. "You won't tell my father, will you? He'll kill me if he knew I'd used his rifle." "He's right. Dad can be awfully mean when dealing out punishments. He bears a grudge for a very long time. He's slow to forgive," said Zachary. "I shan't be telling anybody anything." "But how do you know about this?" asked Caden. "How could you possibly know?"
"The kitchen wall. It's paper thin. I can hear everything. Last night the two Bigfoot pulled back the sliding doors of my own living room when I was watching television. The large female Bigfoot completely obliterated my expensive couch. She was after you, Caden. I imagine since you shot the Bigfoot in the chest, who was clearly her youngling, she was furious about what you'd done."
"You mean the Bigfoot came back for revenge after I shot it?"
"Something like that," I said.
"But they didn't attack you, did they?" said Caden. "I mean, you're absolutely fine."
I nodded. "I'm fine. So are they. The Bigfoot you hit was very young, but he's going to be absolutely fine. Make a full recovery. I cleaned up the wound of his, removed the bullet. It didn't go through him. They have solid bodies that seem to heal fast, so he's going to be absolutely fine."
"Lady," said Caden, looking at me in astonishment, "let me get this right, 'cause it ain't making any sense to me at all. You're too scared to leave the premises of your own home,
but you're not scared to clean up the wound of the most intimidating creature that I've ever seen. That makes you a hell of a brave.
Not really. You see, behind all that hair and their very big size, they're not much different to you and me, really. They're emotionally intelligent, which means they respond to reason, which is why I think you can rest assured you can still kick your soccer ball around the gravestones. I think the female Bigfoot understood what I was saying. I apologized to her on your behalf, saying that I didn't believe you meant it. I think I got through to her, I really do. I do believe she understood. I also believe she accepted my apology on your behalf. You know about our ball games? Well, you could say that shut away in my ivory castle, I tend to see a lot. Why did you shoot the creature, Caden? What on earth happened? Why were you even carrying your father's rifle at the time? What on earth possessed you to shoot at the creature?
Well, it was last Tuesday. We were playing ball in the graveyard, said Caden. I noticed a Bigfoot watching us playing ball together. Once it knew it had been observed, it quickly scurried away. It seemed curious, interested in our game, longing to take a part. I was excited, enthralled by what I'd seen. I told my brothers, but they were sceptical and dismissive. I suspected some Bigfoot may be hanging out in the woods, otherwise I wouldn't have encountered one spying on me like that behind a large spruce tree. I persuaded my brothers to sneak in the woods during the night with me, when my parents were away last night for the entire evening. We knew it was wise to take my father's rifle with us, just as a precautionary measure. I had no intention of using it. I suppose you could say it was a crutch. It made me feel safe, or us feel safe. It was a very bright night. The visibility was excellent. But walking into the graveyard with the dark shadows looming over the stones, well, it was a hell of a creepy. We felt as if ghostly eyes were looking at us. The energy was oppressive. It was heavy. You couldn't hear a frog croak or a cricket chirp, so it was airy. I mean, that's not normal, is it? We began to walk through the trees, realizing an obscure, shadowy figure was stalking us. I knew it was the Bigfoot, but I guess I started to panic. I don't know why I got so frightened. I didn't see it clearly, only its huge, monstrous silhouette, its menacing red eyeshine, which scared the bejesus out of me. When it knew it had been seen, it started to run away. But in my moment of irrational panic, I unleashed a shot into the air. I must have hit it, as I could hear the most god-awful scream. The three of us hightailed it back to the house as fast as we could. We were wetting ourselves. We could hear a raucous scream emanating through the forest, as if someone else had watched us. And the scream put the fear of God into every fibre of our beings. "We were very cross with Caden," said Zachary. "He may be 15 years old, but he can do very stupid things sometimes. He always overreacts."
"It was a rather silly thing to do," I admitted, "especially since the creature was running away from you. It certainly meant you no harm. You must seriously think wisely before you shoot at something at random."
"How can you be sure the Bigfoot female won't come back to hurt me?" asked Caden, his voice wobbling unsteadily.
"Because her little youngling is doing fine," I assured him, "but also because I appeased her. I gave her a huge rose quartz stone, which she absolutely loved. But I think you boys need to do something by way of apology. I've been doing some research for myself. I think you should gift the Bigfoot you hurt by leaving some glass marbles and a box of food in the woods for him, where you shot him. I believe it would be a nice thing for you to do."
"What sort of food?" asked Caden.
"Well, any whole food from nature, like dried fruit, peanut butter, jerky, fruit, nuts, stuff like that."
"We'll do it," said Caden. "I've got some savings. I'll buy the Bigfoot some fabulous treats."
To cut a long story short, my counsellor thought I was a miracle on two legs, because after the Bigfoot incident, I was able to resume my own life. I regained my job at the local school as a teacher, where I'd initially worked. Unfortunately, none of the residents remained living in that old Georgian house, as the landlord eventually sold it to a millionaire who wanted to restore it to its former glory so that he and his tiny family could reside in a huge house that could easily swallow them whole based on its Goliath size. I am still in touch with those boys today, who are now lovely young men. We swore never to tell anyone about the Bigfoots we encountered. We want to protect them from human beings who might wish to cause them bodily harm. But in a discreet forum like this, it's nice to get our story told. From time to time I go to those gravestones. I put glass marbles around them. They're always gone when I return. So they're still out there in those woods. I'm sure of it. So there you are. That's my story. Wow, what an incredible story. Until next time, goodbye and good night.